just for the record, this is John. I'm not John. My name's Robin, founder of Tech.eu. And John and I go some time back. We communicated quite a bit in your previous company. And you're now the product marketing lead at Airbnb. What does that mean? You don't have to introduce Airbnb, that's always a plus, but you can talk about your role.
Sure, yeah. So product marketing means something different at every company. At Airbnb, it's relatively straightforward. It's relatively a lot like what it sounds like. We position the products and bring them safely to market. So for example, right now I'm working on our new Superguest product. It's a loyalty program from Airbnb, but we want to make sure it doesn't look like every other loyalty program. We wouldn't use something like points, for example. So where we have brand marketing, building the brand, which we'll talk about a little bit today, product marketing really thinks about, okay, product has built this product, how are we going to get it out there to users and make sure everyone understands it?
We're going to dive quite deep into that, but how do you these days describe Airbnb? People ask you, we've heard of Airbnb, but what is it? Which is a lot of people still need to figure out.
Yeah.
In the US.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. I mean, our roots obviously are in home sharing. That's the kernel of the idea that Brian, Joe, and Nate started running with in 2008 very successfully. Now we're really starting to describe ourselves more as a whole trip kind of company, is the term that our CEO often uses. We really want to have a vision that we can help you with your trip from end to end. So first with the discovery of the trip, which is sort of broken now, to be honest. If you go on Airbnb.com and you don't know where you want to go in the world, it's not super helpful. But we're going to bring a lot of content there, and then we'll help you eventually actually get to where you're going. Brian's talked about building sort of the airline of the future eventually. And then not only the home that you're staying in, but also what you do when you're in a place. So if you're going to Tokyo, great, you're going to get there, you have a place to stay, but what do you actually do? We've all had the experience, or had a friend have the experience where, oh, you know, I had this Japanese friend, and they took me to this guy who made sushi. I learned how to make rice, and wow, isn't that such great happenstance? What if you could actually find that and book that? We call that experiences, and that's by far our fastest growing segment right now.
How many of you use Airbnb on a regular basis? So, let's say half the room. How many of you have booked experiences rather than a room on Airbnb?
Some
work to do.
Yeah.
But it's actually quite interesting because I was on Airbnb last week. I was trying to book a room in Amsterdam for 10 people, which was impossible, by the way. what struck me most is because I've been using this product for a very long time. What struck me most is that the experiences are being really, really pushed to the users. It's almost no longer about booking the room. It's almost all about, you know, what are you going to do while you're there? Is that also the direction that you want to go in?
It is. It's intentional. Because people know us for home sharing, when we have something so big and new as experiences, and that's really instructive that most of you haven't tried an experience yet, which is shouldn't be surprising. It's hard because I'm in the weeds every day thinking about it, but you've really got to get the word out there. You have to do good product marketing in the product. For example, if you book a place in Amsterdam, hopefully you got an email later that says, hey, Robin, you're going to Amsterdam. You know, here's a few experiences you might try. You've really got to keep at that for some time. To give it the room to grow. Like many products, when experiences launched, it didn't instantly become, you know, $100 million product, but it's grown a lot faster than our homes business did 10 years ago, we'll continue to market it.
So when you say a whole trip experience, it also means transportation.
Yeah.
Right? So at what point are we going to be able to book flights and trains and even buses maybe on Airbnb?
It's something we're definitely thinking about. I think what the future looks like is you go to Airbnb to discover where you want to go. And every piece of your trip can be in one place. I'm talking about your airport pickup, maybe sending your luggage ahead, your flight. I just imagine you book an Airbnb and then it says, hey, by the way, you can go to LA for $250 flat. Click here. We're experimenting with a lot of different ideas there. A loyalty program, so we really want to give you an ecosystem that you can stay within and covers all of the bases, but it's going to take time.
So let's talk about Airbnb, the company. It's been around for 10 years now.
Yes.
You've only been there for about 2 years now?
That's right.
So you came into this company when it was already a bigger scale-up, one of the biggest internet companies in the world. How tough was that to, like, get into that environment, no longer a startup, which you did before, but like a company that's already quite sizable. I don't know how many people were working at Airbnb when you joined.
About 2,500.
It's a big company.
It's a great question. So I had never worked. I'd worked at startups. I'd never worked at a company with more than 150 people before. And so I was a little bit nervous. You know, what is this going to be like? Is it going to be a big bureaucracy? It's already kind of scaled. It was already the valuation was $31 billion when I joined. You know, pretty big. I've been so pleased. There's so much to be done. Just some of the things we've already talked about. Like some of the things I've already mentioned, you might assume there's teams of 100 people working on. There's usually like three people, you know, that need help working on it. So particularly from a product marketing perspective, we've just launched a lot of things. We just announced a lot of things in March. There's more coming. So there's so much to be done. In some ways, it's like being at small startups inside the company when you're working on one of these new products.
I was quite surprised when you mentioned your product marketing team is only 10 people?
Yeah,
strong.
Just 10 people. Facebook has hundreds, Google has thousands. We had an incredible CMO who built a really scaled brand organization. It's well over 150 people. Everything from art directors and copywriters to brand managers and things like that. He really took our business over the last 4 years from this startup in San Francisco to a really a global brand, Belong Anywhere. And so that's the bulk of the department. But I think you're going to see product marketing expand quickly.
Great CMO, but he also left. So how's that being handled in the company right now?
Yeah, good question. He was there for some time. He was there just short of 4 years. Our CEO is very involved. Brian's very involved in every decision. It's a very founder-led company, much like Amazon or Apple. Apple was. So, you know, Brian very recently has been very involved with marketing. We're looking for a CMO. But, you know, he said to us recently, if a CEO is not involved in marketing, what ends up happening is marketing. You know, oh, I don't really get marketing, I don't know, so I hire some executives and they go do marketing over there. I really took that to heart. I think that's really true. The founder really has to be involved in what the message is that's going out to people. So I appreciate that he's involved.
You mentioned in the beginning that there's a big difference between, you know, brand marketing and positioning a brand as such versus product marketing. What are some of the techniques that you've kind of had to learn because you were at startups before, this is a scale-up, product marketing is different. Yeah. What are some of the skills that you had to learn to be efficient at your job?
Yeah, good question. I think it's different for different size companies, of course. So product marketing at a smaller startup really should be done by the founder. You don't see a lot of big product marketing teams at a small place. At a big company, when you have so many different products, you do need to then hire a lot of people to do different things. And then in terms of brand marketing versus product marketing, those are quite different. Brand marketing we think of as more like the megaphone, just getting people to know what Airbnb is, be aware of the brand. You know, we all know Airbnb pretty well. A lot of hands went up earlier. Actually, in the US, only 51% of people have even heard of Airbnb. So there's a long way to go there. And then you could think of it kind of like a funnel. Then when you get down to, okay, Robin's heard of Airbnb, he's interested, he goes to the site, then it's product marketing. It's, oh crap, we don't want him to be confused and think this is a company about sushi lessons. We want him to understand that it's homes and things like this. So that's where product marketing really gets important.
How personalized does it get? How well do you cater to the needs of people in Asia versus Eastern Europe versus Western Europe? Does it differ a lot? Do you customize the experience for different people?
I'd say that the place that we customize the most and we're really doubled down in right now is China. China's just a completely different market. Websites look very different there. Mobile is very different there. Payments are very different there. And so that's somewhere where literally the homepage is different. In most countries, Airbnb looks the same, but we have an incredible research team. I was saying to somebody earlier, you know, they've been going to Germany a lot to do deep dives. One of them just got back from Japan. These are two countries where there are cultural norms that are slightly different from others, other countries we're used to, and we're trying to understand why certain metrics are a certain way. So we're a very global company. We care a lot about different places, but in general, we're pretty uniform.
What are some of the techniques that you use outside of, you know, people landing on your webpage? How do you get them there in the first place?
Yeah, I mean it's a wide funnel at the top in the sense that we've spent good money on brand marketing globally, not just in the U.S. of course, but you know Europe's our biggest market where we sit here today. And then you're saying how do we pull them down? That's where product marketing gets important. So it's, you know, you capture somebody, they're interested. Maybe it's a mom who's heard from her friends to try Airbnb. We launched something, for example, recently called the Family Collection. So she'll see a big tile today if she goes on, and it says Family Collection, and she clicks on that, and those are only homes that have been rated 5 stars by two or more families. They have a crib, they have certain things there. So that is the product of almost a year of work, mostly by product marketing on cross-functional groups, to make sure that we can, when brand sort of captures her attention, we can actually bring her into the product and make sure she understands it.
So the other thing about product marketing for Airbnb is that you kind of have to serve two groups because it's a two-sided marketplace. You have to get hosts, yeah. get people to actually rent out their place in their rooms, and you have to get the guests. So how does the technique of capturing those audience differ from one another?
It's very different. You know, speaking of belonging and community, our community is host-led. Our hosts are so important to us. You know, one of Brian's titles is head of community, and he does host Q&As every month. They're what you see. They're who you interact with. So reaching them through a variety of means is really important. We have something, for example, for hosts called Airbnb Open. Thousands of people. Hosts fly in from all over the world. The last one was in LA. And we took over all of downtown LA, a lot of programming to really help them understand how to optimize their listing and answer their questions and be there in person to meet them. Hundreds of us were there with name tags and things to talk with our hosts. So it's very personal. The guest side is a lot more like traditional growth marketing. We spend hundreds of millions of dollars when you're looking for, you're in market for a trip to Paris. We know that and we'll show you ads and we also have a lot of researchers obviously who are trying to understand the guest. There's a lot of different segments. Product marketers try to understand the different segments of guests and try to figure out how to attract each segment.
So we were talking about this earlier in the bus over here. For us, the people in this room, probably Airbnb is well known. But you said something that I thought was really interesting, is that you still need to convince a ton of people to be comfortable with renting out their own space, their own home. Is that different in US versus Europe? Is it a challenge that's getting easier over the years?
Yeah, it's definitely opening up. I think the future is bright. When we talk to, one thing product marketers do is obviously understand the customer deeply. So I love sitting with researchers, talking to customers myself. On average, if you talk to a 23-year-old, Airbnb is just one of their default options. They've grown up with it. But you talk to a 53-year-old, and on average, and actually we don't even really segment by age demographic anymore, we do it by psychographic. There are a lot of 53-year-olds who are very, we call them headfirst explorers. On average, they may be barely heard about it, or they think it's still something. A lot of people still think Airbnb is you stay always with someone else in the home. You're crashing on some crash pad for a Coachella or something like that you can't have the entire home. So there's definitely a lot of education still to be done, but I think in general it's going to open as the generations age.
What are some of the challenges you face in your role as a product marketer today that you didn't think about 2 years ago when you joined? Like what did you not expect to have as a problem?
That's a good question. I think having more products is smart. I think the things that we are launching, like Superguest, like Experiences, I'm also working on something called Airbnb Nearby. So for a conference like this, when you click accommodations, imagine not only do they show a few hotels, but also an Airbnb widget that pinpoints where is this conference exactly? What are some Airbnbs nearby that are in our For Work collection? You need more people to cover more products. And sometimes you have things happen where, and I know that we're not the only company, oh crap, there's guys in Ireland working on this, and also we're working on the same thing, and we didn't realize till 3 months later. Or, geez, you're adjusting the guest fees to optimize for conversions or transparency or whatever. Well, that's going to affect hosts, or not rental by owner hosts, but pro hosts. We got to go talk to the pro host group. So it's just a function of scaling a company and getting bigger. And we've hired a new head of homes, Greg from Amazon. He was there 18 years running Prime. And he's incredible. And he's really taking a fresh look at the architecture of the company. Because if we're going to go from 3,000 to 30,000 people and one product to many products to create that whole trip, it's going to take some smart architecture.
So one of the things that I think is crucial, especially for early stage startups, is focus. So I hear you talking about this Airbnb Nearby and experiences and homes and a loyalty program, maybe flights. Yeah. Isn't there an incredible risk of trying to be everything to everyone and kind of drifting away from the core mission?
There can be. I think Brian's vision, though, is pretty comprehensive and succinct in that we're not starting a payments company over here, which we could do, by the way. I think we're second to PayPal or something in the world. I've heard some incredible stat. We built all our own payments infrastructure. If you're a Brazilian and you're going to China, we do all of that in the background. We don't use any third parties. But everything is in the name of that whole trip. So we don't do any products that are outside of that. So I think if that's the vision, and for the user as a product marketer, we make sure that everyone can fit in their head, okay, Airbnb was this, now it's this, now it's this, now it's this, but it's the whole trip, I think it will still be relatively straightforward, rather than some of these companies, which I totally agree, are spinning off all kinds of new coins and things like that.
I feel like a lot of the things you're talking about and working on are things that might be launched this year, next year. What's 3-5 years from now? What is Airbnb going to look like?
We've got a really cool group at Airbnb called Samara, which is sort of our 5 to 10 year out idea lab, actually, run by one of our co-founders, Joe Gibbia. My first week at the company, he actually came and talked to us. And he painted a picture of some of these things, just blue skying, but they're working on all kinds of cool stuff like this. But this one really stuck with me. He said to our little recruitment class, you know, imagine, you know, someone's going to buy a home. You're going to buy a home in Grand Rapids, Michigan. What if Airbnb could tell you in 2023, hey, if you buy a home in this area, and you get a 3-bedroom with 2 baths, we have enough data over the last 15 years to know that actually you can Airbnb the back garage or your whole house or whatever it may be, that it will pay for this mortgage. And the house is essentially paid for. There are obviously many people where that happens. That's really exciting. I was just talking to somebody right before I came up here who was telling me that their wife's parents couldn't live without Airbnb. It helps them stay in their home. So there are a lot of exciting things we're working on, all kinds of things with AR. I don't know if I can say, but like, imagine...
We won't tell anyone.
Yeah, private group. Imagine you could walk into an Airbnb and hold your phone and see, oh, right, that's where the light switch is, or that's where the, you know, spatula is, or whatever, some more interesting stuff than that. How do you, you know, you go to the Nest and it says, okay, you know, you got to jiggle it a little bit here or turn it that way. So a lot of cool stuff going on there. You know, our founder and CEO, Brian, is very good at putting a stake in the ground in the future. And, you know, that can be jarring internally when he says, we're going to build this whole super guest program and we're going to announce it tomorrow and nobody's thought it through yet, you know, whatever. But you need that. You need those people thinking 5 to 10 years out. I think when a company like Airbnb or others at this stage die is when they lose that figure, they lose that founder, or at least that founder mindset, and they bring in some executives or whatnot who stop putting those stakes out there. And at first it looks good. Okay, these guys are, you know, going to operate it better or whatever. But over time that can calcify, and that's when companies drift away. So I'm proud to work for a company that's always thinking 10 years ahead.
Speaking of which, I think one of the co-founders, Brian, just mentioned this week or last week in the media that Airbnb might be going public next year, might not. But at least he publicly acknowledged that it's an option, which I think makes sense. You talk about community. He says, you know, public company for us makes sense because we kind of want to be a publicly held company.
Yeah.
Our users should be owners in a way. Right?
It's a double-edged sword. It's not news to anybody, of course. You're under more scrutiny. People are looking at you quarter to quarter. Can you as a public company weather that and still have what Brian calls an infinite time horizon and make decisions based on that? I think Google's done a really good job of that. They've been public for a long time, but they are always thinking way ahead and making big bets. So who knows? I think that's still something being decided. But I think whether we go public or not, you know, as long as the founders are there and they're all very active in the business, we'll keep pushing.
You mentioned China in the beginning. You mentioned earlier to me that it's a very, very challenging environment. Why is that, and how do you plan to tackle it?
Yeah, like I said, I think a lot of people in this room, you know Airbnb, we're in tech. But, you know, if 51% of people in America have only heard of Airbnb, imagine China. Not only is it a massive place where marketing is completely different, but we're newer there. We've doubled down there. One of our co-founders, Nate, is there all the time. We've got a great team there, but it's a couple hundred people. There are several serious competitors there that are better known than us. It's just too big a country to ignore. It's controversial, right? You've seen a lot of companies go into China and eventually get out. It's very difficult to list on one or two hands how many tech companies have been very successful in China. But China is a huge part of the global future, and we want to be a global company, and so I think it's the right decision to really invest.
You have the benefit of working for a scale-up, like a bigger company. What are some of the things that you see other startups do that you think, you know, you have to avoid that?
At this stage or earlier?
Yeah, what are some of the lessons, like early-stage startup, when they are going to scale, they're going to face this problem. So what would you tell them to avoid?
Interesting. I think you kind of nailed it earlier. I'm a really big proponent, actually, of focus. I think knowing what you do well, not looking too hard at competitors, and really, if you stay focused on your own users, I read a great quote recently from a very famous entrepreneur, and I don't remember the quote well enough or the entrepreneur, so I shouldn't have brought it up, but it's like, basically, the competitor, it's something like the competitor I worry the most about is the one that's ignoring me and focused on their own business. That's the one to be scared of, and I think that's the one to be. So I think stay focused on what you're doing. Don't be distracted by the trend of the moment, whether it's AI today, which is, of course, a major trend, or you know, things that come up and down, 3D printing or whatnot, and just have a goal. And have that goal be pretty far out. You know, these startups are hard. So if you're going to be thinking, think big, have a big goal, and if you even get halfway there, you'll be in good shape.
Great. Well, on that note, thank you so much for joining us. Very interesting session. John from Airbnb.